this person for based on their credit score. Okay, cool. Now we know what that is. Then we're going to look at what is their income. So here's their income. Their verifiable, typically verifiable income. Here's what they say that they make. Here's what we verify that they make. So that's about right. And then what do they owe? On a monthly basis, what do their bills look like? That's when we go look in the actual credit report. Okay, they have a vehicle. They have a couple credit cards. Minimum payments, $20 on this one. Minimum payments, $30 on that one. Those kinds of things are what they're looking at. So they look at those things, and then they determine what your debt-to-income ratio is. That's different than your credit utilization. It's your debt-to-income ratio. How much debt do you have compared to what your income is? And so if that fits in within their parameters, then they can be like, okay, cool, we can lend this person some money. If you're under whatever their threshold is, a good debt to income ratio, if you read up on it, is about 35%. So if you're under 35%, maybe you have an issue getting a loan. If you spend all that you make, and this is only based off, you get a couple of advantages, if you will. It's only based off of what's on your credit report. So we all know we owe more people than what's on your credit report. Your cell phone bill, not on your credit report. Your insurance payment, not on your credit report. Your utility bill, not on your credit report. Whatever habit you got, it's not on your credit report, whatever that is, right? So everything's not on your credit report. So you get that advantage when you're filling out an application, because they're not taking into account literally all the money that comes out of your pocket when it comes to this, right? So you get that advantage. And then another advantage that you get is that on those applications, they're taking your gross pay. So your gross pay is what you make. If you make $30,000 a year, it's $30,000 divided by 12. That's what this person makes, period. You and I know, and so do they, that that's not what you bring home, because you got insurance and FICA and, whoever else, right? You have all this other stuff. You're putting money in your 401k, all these things that come out of your credit, that come out of your paycheck. So you have those things, but you get the advantage. One of the advantages is they take off your gross, and that's where they determine your debt to income ratio. So you could be getting denied, because the original question was, I got good credit, but I keep getting denied. Could be around income. And then sometimes it's not. Maybe your income is cool, but you only been at your employer for 5 months. So before, wherever you were doing, if you were that person we were talking about making $30,000, you're making $30,000, but now you make $100,000, but you only been in that employer for 3 months. Well, that's a big jump, no matter who you are. That's a big jump to go from $30,000 to $100,000. And so that means, and maybe you switch industries. So who knows how that job is going to lay out? So those are factors that they look at, and you may be being denied on that basis alone itself. So those are some of the kinds of things, but that you could get denied for. So your credit score is not the be all and end all when it comes to filling out an application and trying to get approved for something. All right. This is, is this the second or last one? Let me get y'all out of here. All right. So here's another question. I want to use one of the tactics that you talk about to decrease my credit utilization. Which one is best? Now, I talk about credit utilization a lot because it's one of the pillars of credit that I think you can impact the most. Personally, that's what I think. So I have several tactics. So you want to use one of these tactics. So let me tell you. So I don't know which tactic this person is referring to. So let me give you and go over a few of them. So one, the snowball. Snowball is when you take your credit cards and you start to pay them off. With the snowball, you got 5 credit cards. They all have different balances. You take the credit card with the lowest balance first, and you start to try to pay it off. So if that minimum is $20 a month and that's what you've been paying, but you're able to find $50 a month to add to it, so you take that 50 plus the 20 you've been paying, and that's $70. You pay that every month until that card is gone. Then you take the next card. All the while, of course, you got to be making your payments on each and every card, right? You're not missing any payments because that's going to lower your score. So then you move to the next card. You were paying $70 on that card, right? So now you have $70 in your pocket. Say you were paying a $30 minimum payment on that next card, the card now that has the lowest balance. You take that $30 you were already paying, and you add the $70 from before, and now you're paying $100 on that card until that card is paid off, and you keep going and keep going that way, adding along the way to get your debt paid off and paid down faster. So that's what you do. That's the snowball. Or you can take the avalanche. There's another one you can do. The avalanche works the same way, except for you don't take the lowest balance first. What you take is the credit card that has the highest interest rate. So, of course, the higher the interest rate, the more interest you pay on that particular card. You take the one that has the highest interest rate. You do the same thing. You add that extra $50 you got to the minimum payment you were making, and then you pay it off until it's done. You take that amount, you go to the next one that now has the highest interest rate, and you pay that one off. And that's how you move down, and that's called the avalanche. So, same concept as the snowball. One, you're dealing with the balances. The avalanche, you're dealing with the interest rates on them. And something else that you can do, of course, to help with your credit utilization, become an authorized user. If you become an authorized user on somebody that has a high limit, they have a high limit on that credit card and a low balance on that credit card, you're going to get the benefit of that that limit placed onto your credit. So that's going to ideally lower your credit utilization. So become an authorized user on someone's card. Increase your limit. So if you got a credit card sitting around and they've offered you an increase and you never took it or whatnot, take that increase in the limit. If you don't spend it, that's going to, every increase in your limit is going to bring down your credit utilization, because you're going to have more availability or you will be available for more credit. So you're going to have that, and that's going to lower your credit utilization. That's why you don't close credit cards. Once you pay them off, you don't close them. That's why you don't close them, because if you do close those cards, then you no longer have access to that limit, and it could actually drive up your credit utilization. So you want to do that. That's one of the tactics that I use as well. So get you that increase in your credit limits. And you can also get another card. Yes, go get another card. If you got decent credit, go get another card. I wouldn't suggest go getting a secured card. You're already having a tough time. You can only get a secured card. If you got money for a secure card, I would suggest taking that $250, that $500, and putting it towards your credit card debt that you already have versus getting a secure card. But if you can go get another card, and some places will give you a large limit right off the bat. If you got a place that'll give you another $10,000, and then you're not using it, that's going to increase your limits and lower your credit utilization. And you can do all of these things pretty much at the same time. You can't do the snowball and the avalanche at the same time, but you can pick the authorized user, the snowball, you can increase your limits, get yourself another card, all those things all at the same time. You can do them all at the same time, and all of them will positively impact your credit utilization, bringing it down, and that's going to raise your credit score. So you don't have to do one or the other. You can do a combination of any of these things, and it'll help you with your credit utilization. So, last one. Do I get points deducted for inquiry even if I'm not approved? Yes. They're going to take those points away from you whether you're approved or not. So every time you apply, they're going to take those points away from you. Except for in that instance we talked about with vehicles and mortgages. Yes, every time you apply, they're going to take points away from you because you apply, whether you're approved or denied. It's also one of the reasons I don't like the inquiry pillar of the five pillars of credit, because I think it's only negative for us. And recently I was reading about Vantage Score, and Vantage Score said each inquiry, you can get deducted 10 or 20 points for each inquiry. That's ridiculous. 10 points just for applying for credit somewhere? That's ridiculous. 20 points just for applying? That's ridiculous. So Vantage 3.0 said if you apply, you can get 10 to 20 points deducted. Experian says you either get 5 points or you get 10 points. In my experience, I usually see from 2 to 10 points if somebody has an inquiry, a new inquiry. They had the credit pulled on there. So those are some of the things and some of the factors that you actually need to that you need to pay attention to. And so that was the last one. But I got a question. I got a favor to ask of you guys. So let me ask you to do this for me. If you're signed up with Credit Karma and you can get your score from FICO, from somewhere, from anywhere, I want you to take a look at them. Take a look at them and let me know which one is higher. I'm just doing a little experiment, collecting a little bit of data. So help me out with this. Contact me. Hit me with all of your information in that regard. You know, which one is higher. You don't have to tell me what your credit score is if you don't want to, but that's cool too. Matter of fact, congratulations to Sean. I'm gonna just say Sean. Congratulations to Sean. 827 credit score. Sent me his score. 827 credit score. Congratulations to you. So do that. Look at your Credit Karma. Or if you're on anybody else, look at your Credit Karma Advantage score, wherever you get it, and see what that score is. Compare it to your FICO score. Now, I use Experian to get my FICO score. So Experian.com is free. I use them to get my FICO score. My FICO score with Experian is a perfect 850. Has been for the last 3 months. With Credit Karma, my score is 821 with Credit Karma. So Credit Karma is lower for me. Some people, maybe your Credit Karma is higher than your your FICO, but I like to see so I can get an idea what they are doing out there. So do me a favor, take a look at them, send me both of your scores. Where are you going to send them? Email me, 800@creditscoreman.com, or text them to me. Just shoot me a text, 312-600-5855. Shoot me a text, and I'm going to take a look at that, and I'll let you know what the results are. I'm probably ask this for maybe for the rest of the year. I'm probably ask this so I can get a good idea of what's going on, which one is higher and whatnot. So thank you in advance for doing so. And thank you for coming in and checking out the 800 Credit Score Man show. Y'all know how I got to do before I get out of here. Kobe, Cameron, and Carter. I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. I'm out.